You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, this is Professor Gus Martin. Welcome to Criminal Justice Administration 443, Criminal Law and Justice Administration. In this session, we are going to review victims and the law, looking at victims' rights, which is something that is actually relatively new in the law, in our particular system in the United States. And it's very important to keep in mind that victimization, although it is very common, we now have safety nets set up to assist victims in their recovery. And the question becomes, who is a victim? Well, clearly, people who are on the receiving end of criminal activity are victims, but perhaps their families are also. Perhaps their support network can be victimized also. So let us explore this. Firstly, in order to understand this, it was actually a law. The Violent Crime Control and Law Enforcement Act of 1994 says that the word victim means any individual against whom an offense has been committed. We understand that. That's the person who is on the direct receiving end of a crime. But then, at the federal level and state level, federal law expands the term to include a parent or legal guardian if the victim is below the age of 18 years or incompetent, and one or more family members or relatives designated by the court if the victim is deceased or incapacitated. So this concept of a victim has been expanded. It has been redefined. And keeping this in mind about the redefinition and the expansion of what a victim is, let us take a quick look at a short history of the victim, because we need to understand why this concept of victimization has evolved to be what it is today. In the common law era, in, of course, merry old England, victims had well-recognized rights, including a personal say in imposing punishments on apprehended offenders. The victim or the victim's family in the common law era could actually mete out punishment against the perpetrator. 1960s, a renewed interest in victims worldwide led to a resurgence of efforts intended to assist them. And today, victims' compensation programs exist in many states to help pay the medical and other costs associated with the victimization experience. And this is important to understand because in the modern era, victims have rights. This means that they can receive assistance from society, from the courts, from the safety nets that have been set up. So there are true victims' rights in the modern era. This did not exist until fairly recently, until beginning the 1960s in the United States. There are certain principles in the victims' rights movement that we need to understand. There are six of them, six principles of victims' rights. Firstly, victims and witnesses have a right to protection from intimidation and harm. They have a right to be left alone. They have a right to be informed concerning the criminal justice process. The courts or the police or some other entity needs to or must stay in touch with them. They have a right to reparations, in other words, to be made whole again, a right to the preservation of property and employment, so that if they were injured or if their property was destroyed, or if they had to stay out of the job market for a while, their job will be there when they come back. Their property will be reimbursed. They have a right to due process in criminal court proceedings. Victims and witnesses cannot be abused by defense counsel or the prosecution. Victims and witnesses have a right to be treated with dignity and compassion. This was not always the case. Sometimes victims were treated as if they were the problem. Now, keeping this in mind, there is something called the Son of Sam laws, which sounds strange. You know, what is a Son of Sam? Well, during the 1970s, there was a serial killer named David Berkowitz in New York City who would walk up to people and randomly shoot them. He was known as the Son of Sam. Now, his name was David Berkowitz, but Notes were passed out by him saying that, discussing Sam, how Sam was talking to him and telling him to shoot people. Sam was his dog. David Berkowitz was what we might say was legally insane. But in order to keep the perpetrator from cashing in on their story, the Son of Sam laws were passed almost universally in the United States. So think about that. The our movies, our television shows frequently will discuss sensational true crimes, but the monies from that will not go to the perpetrator. So you see that there could be book deals, TV and radio broadcasts, film rights, memorabilia sales of various things. It makes a lot of money. Son of Sam laws will place this money in an escrow account and distribute it to the victim or the victim's estate. So basically, perpetrators cannot actually make a fortune, if you will, from their behavior. And then the aftermath of a criminal offense for the victim. Let's say they were battered. They have lost time at work, fear of retaliation. They're uninformed legally. Hospital fees and service forms. All of these things happen to perhaps this victim who was on the receiving end of a battery. Victims assistance programs are there to try and make them whole again. So there is help for victims coming from victims, various kinds of victims escrow accounts or whatever it might be. Now, very importantly, and you may have seen this in some proceedings, victims' impact statements are now very much a part of the sentencing process. In other words, the victims, however defined, will explain to the court the extent to which they've been victimized after this event, this criminal event, and how it has affected them. And this is called the victim's impact statement. So the modern trend is that there's an ongoing call for the use of victim's impact statements at the sentencing phase of a trial. Victim's impact testimony received at the sentencing phase and not at the trial originally was invalidated by the Supreme Court, but it reversed itself. The Supreme Court reversed itself and thereby permitting the admission of written and oral testimony about the victim, about the impact of the offender's crime and that it had on his or her victims. So understand that the victim's impact statement is when a victim gets up and explains what happened to them and the effect it had. And this can be very moving testimony. There are some scenes that are just heart-wrenching when you listen to them. The parents of a child victim, for example. So the victim's impact statements can have a dramatic effect on the judge, on the court. Now, how do we know there's crime? How do we know that there's been victimization? Local, state, and federal agencies collect statistical information, and they do have a statistically sound sample. So these statistics tend to be very accurate within the parameters of what they are studying. For example, there are two major surveys, and this is just examples. The National Incident-Based Reporting System, also known as NIBRS, and the National Crime Victimization Survey, or NCVS. They provide annual crime statistics for the United States in an effort to measure the extent of criminal victimization throughout the nation. So what you see here is that when you hear about the crime rate, let's say for the year 2022 or something, those data were derived from these surveys, from these systems, these reporting systems. The NCVS is the government's primary source of information. Twice each year, data are obtained from a nationally representative sample. They study households, roughly 50,000 households and roughly 100,000 people. They ask about the frequency, characteristics, and consequences of criminal victimization. And then the BJS, the Bureau of Justice Statistics, annually polls people over the age of 12 about rape, robbery, assault, larceny, burglary, and motor vehicle theft. So you see, within the parameters of what they are requesting information about, these are good data, actually. In the NCVS, what we see is that there are three classifications that they break out: violence against women, violence against young black male victims, and elderly victims. These three are broken out because of the special nature of the criminal activity within these groups. And so this is reported separately or along with other victimizations that occur within the survey. The uniform crime reports, UCR, is done by the FBI. It collects data about offenses known to law enforcement in two major categories: property crime and violent crime. And it collects information about the so-called clearances of these offenses. A clearance simply means arrests. This is information about whether an arrest has been made by the local law enforcement. The NIBRS, or NIBRS, expanded offense data, which include detailed information about victims, offenders, circumstances, and trends in crime volume and crime rates per 100,000 inhabitants. So what we see here is that there are several layers, several approaches, several parameters that all report crime in the United States. And this is very important because we need to understand how to allocate resources to areas where there might be high or low crime rates. So I'm Professor Gus Martin, and thank you very much again for joining me. If you have questions, please feel free to contact me at any time. The most efficient way to contact me is via email, or you can join me during my virtual office hours. So thank you for joining in on this session, and we will see you next time. Take care.